here's Giancarlo on the sign stealing scandal. This was this morning in Tampa.
I think that for they did a very poor job of bringing their side to it. I mean, they didn't have a problem being in front of the cameras and enjoying all the light when they were doing it in 17, and now they have to explain themselves and point fingers and talking for this guy's talking for this guy, and you know, you gotta own up when the time comes.
And he goes on with his issues with the scandal.
The way they've handled it, yeah. I don't think the penalties were harsh enough, player wise. I think that at the end of the day, it gives more incentive to do that if you're not going to punish the players took part in it.
All right, so this is a jumping off point because toward the end of yesterday's show, Rob Manfred, the commissioner of baseball, was giving his second address in the last 3 days. This one was in Arizona at the spring training homes of the Arizona teams. And he essentially, what he did was he put the ball in the court of the Players Association. So all the players are angry, and they're angry at Manfred for not disciplining the Astros. And we laid this out yesterday, and Manfred more forcefully laid it out. He said the rules of engagement in being able to talk to the Astros, the rules of engagement drawn up by the Players Association, was that they must be granted immunity or they would not allow them to speak to investigators. So 3% of the union, 3% out of 100, 3% of the union played for the Astros in 2017. So that means 97% seem like they're very, very angry at what the Astros did. But I think their anger is misplaced. Yeah, you can be angry at Manfred for his heavy-handed, dumb comment about piece of metal when he's talking about the commissioner's trophy. Be angry at him about that. You can be angry at him about the baseball, whatever you want, but don't be angry at him when it comes to not disciplining players. He didn't have it on his plate.
Our role and our right and our responsibility.
What is that, Peter?
That wasn't me. It was an accident. Oh. It wasn't my accident, though.
Okay. So the bottom line is you can't force a guy to do what he legally cannot do. Now, the Players Association, rather than, as Andrew would say, just take the L, they come back and said, they said they didn't want to prosecute the players, that they didn't want to punish the players. That was never even on the table. Yeah, they said that, but obviously if they had found something they didn't like, they would have wanted to punish the players. But then the union came back, which is their right, and said, we're not letting you talk to them unless that's in writing that they're granted immunity. So blame whomever you want, but at the point of the discipline, there is no way whatsoever that Manfred could actually discipline the players, which leads me to one thought. This is what the players want, and this is what's doable, everybody. Take the title away. Somebody on Twitter today said, and I thought it was a really, really smart thing. If you went up to an owner, any owner of a major league team, and said, listen, if you give me $5 million and you promise to fire your manager and GM and give us your first and second round picks for 2 years and you'll win a World Series, will you take that deal? Every single owner would take that deal. Every single one. So the Astros are not even staggered by this punishment. But if the players expect Altuve and Bregman and Gurriel and Springer to be suspended, then talk to your union leadership. Don't scream about Rob Manfred. I hate to say he's the innocent one here because I think he's been fat-handed about this, but he does not have it in his power to discipline. Those were the rules of engagement in talking to the players. So how can he go back on that? He can't. The one thing he does have in his power would be to take the title away. And Don, I'll ask you, do you believe if he takes the title away that that would satisfy the players, that the players of the Astros then would have suffered some negativity?
It would be much better than it is now. I don't think it would completely heal things, but would it be a salve? Because at the end of every comment, it's they got away with it. I'm unhappy with the discipline. I'm unhappy that they weren't punished by it. I think the majority of the players would be more than happy. Now, Tony Clark spoke today. Did he say anything of note? I mean, I'm perusing right now.
Well, here it is. We have a cut of him. Not our job to discipline players.
Our role and our right and our responsibility in the conversation is protecting those rights of every player, not just the Houston players, not just any of the other 29 teams. We are going to do that. Our role is not to discipline players. Now, having said that, what you likely saw in the statement that you saw last night is trying to appreciate what next step looks like as a result of what we've seen manifest itself over the course of the last year or so, or last couple of years or so. And in doing so, in our engagement with the league, it's included a conversation in talking about player discipline as it relates to sign stealing.
Tony's talking gobbledygook, and I feel for him, too, because...
Well, thank you, because I was trying to understand it, and I can't understand
it. Bottom line is... Even if they're the worst, in any union, the worst people did the worst things, they are legally obligated to defend those people. They are legally obligated to defend the 3% of their constituency that actually did cheat. They can't just walk away from them and go, oh, they're cheaters. So Tony Clark's in a tough position. He has to defend them. He has to protect the players. That's why he asked for immunity. They gave immunity to talk to them. They gave it up. They said they cheated in 2017. And now Manfred's asked, well, go back on your... Can you imagine how the players and the Players Association would react if Manfred went back on the immunity that he granted them? That wouldn't be right either. That's why we're going around and around in circles. By the way, the guy who tweeted out about if you gave that offer to any owner is Eric Boland of Newsday. I thought it was a really, really smart thing that he said. That's nothing. It's a small price to pay for a championship. Championships are hard to come by. They really are. But I don't know what the end game is here. I don't understand the players being angry at Manfred. I don't get that. I understand Justin Turner being angry about the medal comment. That was ridiculous. It is not befitting a Cornell and a Harvard Law School graduate. It's a brain cramp that Manfred had. And to give him credit, yesterday he said, I'm sorry. It was a dumb thing to say, and I'm sorry. I apologize. Okay, so that's it. There's nothing more you could do with him. But they keep saying they should have been punished more when their union is protecting them from being punished more.
And what Tony Clark is falling down on is, don't go out after me. These are our rules. Hannah Kaiser, who covers baseball for Yahoo,
does a great job,
has this quote from Tony Clark. Neither MLB nor the league wrote immunity on a slip of paper and slid it across the table. The existing rules made it difficult, if not impossible, to discipline players. Those rules might change going forward.
Oh, that's
so
good.
But it's just the idea that Tony Clark demanded something. I guess Tony Clark's trying to absolve himself, saying, I'm just playing by our union rules.
Right.
And that hopefully that will change moving forward. And I think that's a step in the right direction as well. What I wanted to see was dialogue between the two parties. Now, Jeff Passan made a very good point, and something that I had not considered is that there's a legal obligation Tony Clark has to support the players.
Yeah.
Even the few players. Even if 99% of his union is against it, legally he has to defend the 1% or even less than 1% representing the Houston Astros. That's what Tony Clark is saying here is, I didn't ask for immunity. It's built in. You know, so... But now we can open it up and maybe change those rules. I think that's what baseball has to do right now going forward is learn their lessons, make sure something like this doesn't happen again. If you were to do that and then take the title away, I think that might be enough for closure and for us to be able to move forward knowing that something like this could never happen again.
We need to start with the point, though, Michael, that now every day you're saying in particular, why are you mad at Manfred? Why aren't you mad at the players' union? We need to have that asked to players directly.
Right.
Are they maybe missing it? Like, I know that sounds silly and ridiculous, but let's be clear.
No, it's fair.
Some of these
fair
players may not be paying that much attention to it, and they're just blaming Manfred. And I'm a member of SAG-AFTRA. I'm not paying attention to what's happening. So maybe they're not realizing, hold on, this might be on us.
Well, this is exactly what happens with the Players Association and the NFL. They all hate Roger Goodell. They all hate the power that he has, but nobody ever discusses we gave them the power. We gave him the power.
And a lot of that comes from apathy about voting and paying attention
to
their union.
When the CBA expires, they need to take note of this and make sure that the changes happen. Don't just go to Cabo and just let your union representatives worry about it. Get more involved. An example of two of the biggest sports in this country where the players are just completely ignorant to the process. I remember in the NHL when they were going through the lockout, Peter, where their lives were being affected. There were players that had no idea what was going on with negotiations, had no idea what they were even fighting for. Because players, they just disconnect. They don't know.
Rick DiPietro, who was a member of the NHL union, just texted me. He said, most players have no idea what's going on with their own union.
None.
He said, you can barely get guys to meetings.
Thank you, Rick.
And you know whose fault that is? The player rep. I mean, the player rep is the one that's supposed to know and make sure he communicates it to everybody
fault.
Else.
It's the player's fault.
No, I understand that, Michael, but it's like saying that it's their fault for being stupid.
But you know the player's rep is the most unforgiving job. You don't get paid anything. You're the bad guy to ownership because you have to give the grievances. Nobody wants to be a player rep.
But,
no one.
But you're obviously a liaison, so you can educate your teammates.
Yeah, but you can tell
them,
you can
guys,
tell the team, by the way, and they still don't want to do it. I mean, they're living great lives.
Interesting. They don't want to do it, but they're the first to complain about it when it affects them.
Now, here's another aspect of this as well. Michael Conforto in Port St. Lucie today talked about how they cannot let this, where there's internecine fighting within the union, affect the upcoming CBA negotiations. Here's the Mets outfielder, Michael Conforto.
There's a fight coming in 2021, a new CBA, and something that we need to be focused on, something we need to be unified for, when that time comes. As far as our guys, I think, like I said, we're pretty unified in our answers and our things that we wanted. The goal is to stay unified. I mean, I have no doubt that the league will come together. Right now it's tough with all the things that have been going on, but I think, the players union is going to be very, very strong and unified, when that time comes.
It's going to be interesting to see how, even in an all-star game setting, the Astro players are going to be embraced, or will they be embraced? I don't think they will be, and they're going to be part of union negotiations as well. Now, there was a really interesting, it's almost a must-read story by Evan Dreilich in The Athletic. And by the way, The Athletic has been far and away above this, in front of this story, more than any other outlet. They've been great. They broke the story. They're the ones who started it, Ken Rosenthal and Evan Dreilich. And Dreilich wrote yesterday that even if there was no immunity granted, the people that run Major League Baseball are really smart. They have really smart lawyers. There is no way that Manfred could have disciplined a player, and there's no way that that discipline would have held up in an arbitration case or an appeal, because none of the players were ever notified of the threat of suspension. It would have been shot down within hours. And Major League Baseball would have looked bad, which is probably the reason why Manfred quickly agreed to the immunity. Let's get the story out so at least we could stain them with the fact that they cheated. But if they had not granted immunity and they had, in fact, tried to discipline the players, every single discipline, case by case, would have been thrown out and Major League Baseball would have been laughed at.
I would never condone this publicly. But looking at everything that went down, the way that it has happened, wouldn't it have been just better if he just said we didn't find anything?
Yeah, but then that could get out too. Because then you make Mike Fiers look bad.
But you got a lot of guys looking bad that are assuming that something happened in 2019. They say we didn't find any buzzers. That ticked a lot of people off.
Mm-hmm.
But I understand how uncomfortable that is, and it's condoning lying. But really, what did you get out of this, Michael? You got one of the biggest controversies in the history of the sport. People are complaining there was really no discipline, right?
But you can't ask him to do a cover-up, Don.
But what you ended up getting out of it is nothing. Three guys got suspended and one guy got fined. A billionaire got fined $5 million and three guys lost their job. Three, in the grand scheme of things, outside of Carlos Beltran, everybody that got fired are nameless, faceless people as far as the masses are concerned. And meanwhile, you've got one of the biggest controversies of all time.
But I think they were thinking right along with you. There were 10 to 12 teams that were complaining to Major League Baseball about what the Astros were doing, and they couldn't find anything. Did they really want to? But when Mike Fiers became public with it in The Athletic, it forced their hand. This was a member of the team who said that they were cheating, so they could not sweep it under the rug. He made it public. And that's why there are a lot of people that don't like Mike Fiers in this either.
But they could have very easily done the same thing in 2019, right? 2019, you've got all these allegations, all this video, that there were buzzers, there were working with stuff, to the fact where people just assumed that they cheated in 2019.
Well, they've essentially said they haven't, so maybe they are sweeping under the rug.
So they might be doing it right now. And if we do find out, Michael, that they have swept it under the rug, then why not sweep the whole thing under the rug? We'd be none the wiser, and you still have people that go out...
Fiers made that impossible. He made that impossible. The 10 to 12 teams that were complaining, they right. wanted something done, and Major League Baseball did nothing. They sat on their hands. They didn't want this out, because you're right. What good comes of it?
I couldn't do it. I'm just saying, when you look at how it's happened, you'd have the allegations. Fiers would look bad. You'd have some owners complaining about it. But at the end of the day, we'd be moving on to baseball. It'd be over. Yeah, Mike Fiers looks bad. But now you've got 700 players complaining every single day. What an awful job that you did. Manfred's getting ripped all over the place. It might have just been easier to say we did an investigation, we didn't find anything, because that's what I'm thinking they did in 2019 anyway.
Well, it's interesting because we've told you about the handcuffs that he has on in disciplining players, but the one thing that he has in his toolbox that he can use is taking away the title. And the argument that there's no precedent of that, then set a new one, baby. And I think the thing that he fears the most is that if he takes away the 17 championship, he's going to have to take away the Red Sox one, too. Because the Red Sox one, since it's dragging out 2 weeks longer than anybody thought, they probably found something, and he's got a lot of pressure on him now to really spank the Red Sox hard. Really. Because if he does another really flaccid kind of punishment, does that help? He's going to look worse.
And I really think he's been reading the tea leaves. We were supposed to find this out last Monday.
Yep.
It was supposed to be early last week we were supposed to find out the Red Sox discipline. Is he sitting there just kind of getting a feel of what everybody's going to say and then determining the punishment for the Red Sox? Because why is it taking so long?
I don't know. Well, he said that something came up. They had to re-interview people. That doesn't sound great. Because we spoke to Dan Shaughnessy a couple of weeks ago, said they're going to get a slap on the wrist. Said nothing that they did was terribly wrong.
This is I'll never get a Yankee fan to agree with this because they all hate the Red Sox. But wouldn't it be unfair if the Red Sox essentially did the same thing and they get punished harder than the Astros just because of what's happening in the court of public opinion?
Yeah, you're right.
I mean, that wouldn't be fair, would it?
No, that would be it'd actually be the ultimate disrespect.
Right.
You know, how could anyone stand for that? You're just okay because someone got punished, even if it's not the worst offenders?
The only way that you have to possibly satisfy a frothing Players Association from 97% is to take the title away. It's a no must, no fuss.
It's really
thing.
No brainer.
The Astros should not have the title. Neither should the Dodgers, and neither should the Yankees. That should be a vacant title. And don't tell me there's precedent, because there was no World Series played in 1994. And when it was for the good of collective bargaining, then that was great. There was no precedent for canceling a World Series. They played in two World Wars and played World Series. But they canceled it in 94, so you made precedent then, and now you can take this title away and clean up this mess a little bit.
I wonder if he'd be more apt to do it if it was just 2017. Because if he bangs the Astros, Michael, then he's probably going to have to take the title away from the 18 Red Sox.
You're right. But from what I've heard of the Red Sox, I don't think that they did anything as bad as that, because I've said this before. The Red Sox looked at cameras and got the progression of signs. All right, this succession of signs means this. They didn't bang any drums or anything. The only way that they could take advantage of getting those signs is to get a runner at second base. To me, that's more gamesmanship. The Astros are straight out cheating. And I think the Red Sox did a letter of the law because they used electronics. That's cheating as well. But it does show you how important electronics are, because the bottom line is they're looking to take electronics out of the game where a player cannot go into the video room during a game, which I think is a good idea. J.D. Martinez doesn't want that. Players want to see every swing that they took in the previous at bat. Sorry, something's got to give. So if you want people to stop cheating, you've got to take electronics out of the game. So much cross purposes here. It's amazing. 1-800-919-3776. 3776. A lot of stuff to talk about. This is the story that literally will not die. And Joe Maddon, the manager of the Angels, came out and said, you got to let it go. Well, you weren't affected. Your Cubs didn't get rooked out of a championship. The Dodgers did. The Yankees got rooked out of a possibility of playing in a World Series. Other teams had to face them 19 times a year, sometimes 10 times at Minute Maid Field. So, Joe, pipe down. Let people get it out of their system. I agree with what Don said earlier, though. You don't want to go on all year, but this is the time when players are speaking for the first time to the media. Of course they're going to give their take. Judge gave his take. Stanton today gave his take. Conforto gave his take. Before that, Trout gave his take. Bellinger, that's people have to, if they're not getting satisfaction, they've got to at least tell people why they're mad.
What legend hasn't spoken yet that could somehow be any bigger than we've already gotten, considering everyone from Cody Bellinger to LeBron James has spoken?
Like baseball legend?
Yeah. Is there any like
active player?
No. Or former. That's just such a massive voice.
Well, great ball. Hank Aaron said they should be suspended for life.
Right. You should have Hank Aaron.
Well, Mays hasn't said anything. Sandy Koufax. I never want to diminish what they mean. That doesn't mean anything right now. It's the players that have to play against the Astros.
Right. I'm just trying to think of what, if you have the biggest players in the game all saying these things that show their clear passion for the subject and nothing has been done, we're just going to keep talking and nothing's going to change?
It looks like Manfred is dug in. It doesn't seem like he wants to vacate the title, but if these players keep talking and putting the heat on, maybe that's the only thing to do, because the union doesn't want the Astros penalized as a player, and they won't allow it. And you signed a binding immunity agreement, so you can't do any. The thing you can do that can throw a little bit of chum to the Sharks, take the title away, so at least it's not ill-gotten gains. Because, again, as Eric Boland of Newsday tweeted out, every team would take that deal. $5 million, two draft picks of 2 years, I get rid of my GM and manager, as long as we're world champions. Take the title away. It's not that hard.